Well, I'm going to show you a few examples. As I said, you can generate internal waves with a tide or with a fixed frequency forcing. So imagine that the tides are making the water slosh back and forth. It's sloshing back and forth over a fixed point. It could be a piece of topography or it could be a shelf break. And at that location, there's a kind of there's going to be some agitation that's going to generate a wave. And because you know the frequency and because you know the stratification, you know the angle of the wave phase propagation. From here, you can have things going up in very specific direction. Here too, it's going up this way, it'll go down this way. It can reflect off the bottom, it can reflect off the surface or off the thermocline. And so you have these paths mapped out in the ocean for the passage of these tide-generated internal waves, which are called internal tides. And so there are particular locations here, where you're going to see some evidence of these structures. This is a numerical experiment which was done in a fixed box, right? I think it was just shaken at a particular frequency, the fluid, and there's a point there to generate a disturbance. And so you can see this, it's the anomaly of the stratification. It's maximum along these lines of wave propagation, which will reflect off the surface, reflect off the boundary of the domain, reflect off the bottom, and it goes in all four directions off this generating point. Here's another example of internal waves generated at the bottom of the ocean or at the surface of the Earth in the atmosphere. Let's say we have a flow at a certain speed across some regular topography with an amplitude H and a stratification N here. As you flow across this topography, your frequency will be determined by your flow speed. So yeah, Z, the elevation here that you feel, will be L times X, because that's where it is in space, plus a thing you add to X, which is U times T. So it's L times X plus UT, because you're flowing across it. Or if you want, you can imagine that you're in a fixed position and the terrain is just passing in the opposite direction beneath you. Basically what that means is that you can identify omega T with L times U. So if you take that omega equals L times U, that gives you your forcing frequency, the frequency of the forcing associated with the speed of the flow across these regular bumps. Plug that into the left-hand side of the dispersion relation. So you have this dispersion relation is equal to L squared times U squared, omega squared. And so that gives you, simplify that down, you get little n squared is equal to big N squared over U squared minus L squared. Why are we interested in little n squared, the square of the vertical wave number? Because there are two possibilities for this equation, right? Either this is positive and little n is real, or this is negative and little n is imaginary. Now, if little n is real, that means you have vertically propagating waves, which means you have communication between the bottom and the rest of the ocean. Right? If little n is imaginary, then you have exponential decay and you have all the wave oscillation activity is trapped in a kind of exponential boundary layer. Right? So you don't have communication. Your surface, your bottom boundary layer is cut off from the rest of the fluid. So this is important because if you remember, we were talking about Stommel, for example, Stommel gyres. And the idea was that there was friction with the bottom, which was retarding the circulation. How does friction at the bottom communicate with the rest of the ocean? Well, it could communicate with internal waves, but only if they are free to propagate vertically, which means that little n has to be real, which means that n over u is greater than L. Okay, so in that case, either you have a strong stratification, or your topography is fairly large scale, or your current is not too fast. And then, so the forcing frequency is lower than the buoyancy frequency, and you can have a traveling wave, a wave that propagates vertically, and the bottom can cause a drag on the vertically integrated mean flow, right? On the other hand, if n is imaginary, well, you have the opposite conditions. You have either weak stratification or a small-scale topography or a fast current, and in that case, n is imaginary, and you have a boundary layer which is isolated, and you don't have an effective way of exercising friction on the depth integrated flow. So internal waves and the conditions in which they are generated are important for the large scale ocean circulation, right? And this is one example of that type of consideration.